Today, hours before American envoy General Anthony Zini was due to meet Israeli and Palestinian security officials, another suicide bomber killed at least 7 people. The militant Islamic group Jihad has claimed responsibility. The Israeli and the Palestinian officials said that the security meeting was still on. The bombing occurred one day after an apparent shift in the Bush administration's strategy for the Middle East. Vice President Dick Cheney said yesterday that he was prepared to meet soon with Yasser Arafat if the Palestinians take steps to stop the violence. Joining me now is Henry Siegman. He is senior fellow and director of the U.S. Middle East Project at the Council on Foreign Relations. I am pleased to have him here, certainly after our last conversation, which generated such response in terms of the nature of what he had to say about his observations in a positive way. Thank you for coming back.
Thank you for having me.
A lot has happened in terms since we talked. Give me a sense of where it is you think now. And I mean by that, just to put it in perspective for people who didn't see the first conversation, you talked about the necessity of American involvement. They are involved, envoy back there, and saying he's a presidential envoy as well. You have Sharon meeting with Cheney. You have some pullback of Israeli troops. You have yesterday the announcement that Cheney might meet with Arafat. You have all those developments. What else should I take into consideration, and where are we at this moment?
Well, let me try to divide this into 3 stages. Before the Cheney trip, American policy up until that point. During the trip, what Cheney encountered, what he learned, and how it affected U.S. policy. And then the third segment, where it may lead.
Okay.
Now, to review quickly, up until Cheney's visit, U.S. policy was essentially let the two parties duke it out. When they get tired of it, when enough blood has been spilled and they come to us, we'll step in, but not before. And for all practical purposes, this meant that the U.S. gave the more powerful of the two parties, Israel, a green light to do what it thought it had to do in order to further its interests.
And it roared right through the green light.
Exactly. In fact, just before the visit by the vice president to various Arab countries and to Israel, Sharon announced, this was after our last talk, Sharon announced that he made explicit what had been implicit until then. He said he understood and he wants Israelis to understand that the only way Israel can get where it wants to be is if it really beats up the Palestinians. If there are so many Palestinian deaths and there's so much destruction, that Palestinians will be on their knees. And he said that's the time when we can sit down and discuss a future for the Palestinian people, not before. And this was an extension of what he understood to be the American position as well, that he has a free hand to do this sort of thing. That was up until the vice president's visit. Vice President takes the trip, wants to focus on Iraq, wants to insulate Iraq from other issues, and particularly the Israeli-Palestinian issue. And that is the one thing Arab countries won't allow him to do. Arab leaders will not permit him to do. And they say to him, you want to talk to us about Iraq? We have our differences, but you want to talk to us about it? If we want to survive, you must deal with the Palestinian issue. Otherwise, we can't talk. We can't attend to your agenda. Mm-hmm. And I think he learned a very important lesson. He came away very chastened, very sobered, and he arrived in Israel, chastened and sobered. And the consequence of that was that a new message was sent to Israel from the Bush administration. It is as a result of this message, which said, listen, we have very important business in Iraq, and you are hurting us. You're standing in the way. So what we want you to do is to get off this position that you will not consider ending your counterviolence, your responses to Palestinian terror, and you will not agree to establish a ceasefire unless the Palestinians have 7 days of nonviolence, absolute total nonviolence. It's unrealistic, can't happen. Secondly, you imprisoned Arafat. We want him out. he was in Ramallah, wasn't allowed to move. He has to get out. Indeed, we want him to go to Beirut, where the Arab League will meet and where the Crown Prince will try to get his initiative approved. And when the Vice President gets there, that's exactly what what Sharon informs him he is prepared to do. So the tables have turned, and they've turned in a very fascinating way, because now it is Arafat who is saying to the Israelis and to the Americans, I'm not ready to agree to a ceasefire unless my conditions are met. And it is Sharon who is insisting, let's sit down and talk right away. And the reason for this is that Arafat has come to the conclusion that he's winning, that in fact he will achieve more by keeping up this pressure on Israel and on the United States, given America's own unique agenda, which at least now does not overlap with Israel's agenda.
So Arafat believes that the best thing he has going for him is America's interest in the war against terrorism and the necessity to change the regime in Iraq.
Exactly.
And the knowledge that unless they can do something to control this violence.
Mm-hmm. So this is where we're at now.
So what's the next step? What's the next shoe to fall?
Now, I think there's likely to be agreement on a ceasefire, because it is in the American interest. The U.S. needs that kind of a ceasefire. And at this point, Sean understands. He understands two things. He, of course, understands that the United States has decided this is really essential to its interests. He also understands, I believe, something else, that his strategy hasn't worked. That beating up on the Palestinians does not bring him down to their knees.
Okay. I mean, that, I want to underline and underline and underline. That's amazing for him to come to that conclusion. I mean, you have reason to believe there is evidence, other than simply the fact that he pulled back, that he's come to the conclusion that, in a sense, killing Palestinians is not the best way to achieve Israeli security.
You have formulated it just right, because the responsibility of a government and of a Sharon is his citizen security. It is not to pursue God's absolute justice, and perhaps Palestinian terrorists deserve to be punished. But if it doesn't achieve what a government has as its very first responsibility, which is the security of its citizens, then it's a policy that is bankrupt. And I believe that this has dawned on him, and perhaps more importantly, on Israel's citizens. And this is why his popularity has dropped precipitously. And he is looking at alternative ways of dealing with the situation.
In the meantime, okay, so what, in the meantime, the United States is encouraging the parties to talk. Right. So Cheney will meet with Arafat? He'll come back to the region?
He has said that he will, although I should point out that Palestinians generally are deeply offended by his refusal to meet with Arafat now while he was there. They saw this as playing into Sharon's demonization of Arafat, Sharon's insistence that Arafat remains irrelevant.
Do you think it was a mistake on the part of Cheney?
Yes, I think it was a mistake. And especially the way he did it, because the way Sharon has dealt with Arafat is like one deals with a little child. Let's see how you behave. Let's see if you deserve to be taken more seriously. Let's see if we can allow you out of your cage in Ramallah. And one, his deputy reported to the Knesset when there was criticism over the fact that he has permitted him to leave Ramallah. He said, well, Sharon is only permitting him to go from the cage in Ramallah to his cage in Gaza. Now there's the question of whether we can allow him to go to Beirut. It's this kind of an attitude that Palestinians deeply resent, because it is consistent with a kind of humiliation that Sharon believes Israel has to inflict on the Palestinians, okay, in order to achieve their goal.
Could we also argue, though, that by his own actions in terms of what Arafat is saying, rather than saying, look, you know, we've gone too far I want to be a real statesman. I really do want to find some peace here. And so now that Sharon has done this, whatever reason, because he realized it was a silly start, it was a strategy that would fail because of American pressure, because of whatever reason. I mean, it's a little bit childish too for Arafat now all of a sudden say, well, not so fast. I'm not sure I want to have these talks. It's a little bit like a child who gets his way because,
yeah,
and therefore does not behave.
That's true. Arafat, however, has a problem. First, let's establish he's not a statesman.
Right.
Never was.
Yes. And then, you know.
Palestinians have been cursed by his leadership. He's not a Mandela. And that's very much.
Yeah, but that's a high standard. I mean, there's something in between he could be
and still achieve something.
He's
not even one tenth of Mandela.
Right. But you know what I mean. I mean, he's not.
Yes, indeed. But having said that, you know, people think that if only Palestinians and Arafat stop the violence, that will have reestablished a kind of a parity between the parties.
Right.
They're standing on level ground. But that's not the case. When Palestinians end the violence, in a sense, they have restored an imbalance between the parties. Because Israel's goal is security. Israel has a state. They're not struggling for a state. They are struggling for security. They want to end Palestinian violence. If Arafat agrees to the end of violence, Israel has what it wants. Palestinians have not achieved anything.
Okay, but you're saying that you almost are saying that the Palestinians have a reason to continue the violence.
Unless, and this is what I was trying to lead up to, unless they are told up front, if you end the violence, there are concrete political gains that you can achieve. We can't give these to you while you're carrying on this violence, because we will not condone violence or terrorism. But we want you to understand that if you pay the price, and there's a big price to be paid by him for ending the violence, because he has to take on not only Hamas and Jihad, which was the case in the past, today virtually he has to take on the entire Palestinian population. They're all involved in this intifada. It is no longer just an intifada of some extremist.
Yeah, it's also Fatah too.
So if you clamp down and pay the price for doing that, there are some very concrete political benefits that will accrue. And that's the question for the days ahead.
And the hardest question, seems to me still, though, the two things that I'm curious about. One, does in the end, when push comes to shove, Arafat have the position, have the will to make that step forward, to do that, and because of the goal at the end of the tunnel, number one. And number two, where are the Saudis and the Egyptians and the Jordanians and others in terms of, for the lack of a better expression, keeping his feet to the path of ceasefire negotiations, the establishment of a Palestinian state?
Well, there's even an added question. If he has the will, has he got the capacity to do it?
Yeah.
Is he able to control the violence? My impression is that he has the will, but he does not, there is this sense.
He has the will.
He has the will, which is to say he wants a Palestinian state alongside of Israel. He wants a viable, successful Palestinian state. He wants to be the father of his nation, not just a revolutionary leader.
You sure?
I'm not sure of anything. But that is the impression I have, having talked to him and met with him over the years.
That he genuinely does want that, and he
yes.
wants it before he
yes.
dies, and he wants to get it, but is he prepared
to pay the price?
No, is he prepared to go along with this, just take the deal that's on the table that the Saudis are offering?
Yes, the deal that the Saudis are offering is the deal that he is prepared to take.
And do you think today the Israelis are closer to giving that deal, making that deal, closer because of the failure of this other strategy?
I think the answer to that is yes. If you're talking about the Israeli people, if you're talking about this particular government, the answer is no. Sharon and his government can't
make that
accept,
deal.
No, cannot make that deal.
Because Netanyahu stands on the sidelines?
That's a very large part of it. And they themselves, Sharon and most of the parties who make up his government, are dedicated to not permitting that kind of a deal.
What are they dedicated to?
They're dedicated to allowing, this is essentially a government, a settlement government. It is a government dedicated to the protection of the preservation of the settlements. And consequently, what follows from that is to prevent the emergence of a Palestinian state along the lines of the Saudi proposal, which would wipe out most of the settlements. So this government,
I thought they could make some changes there. You got some kind of approval from the Crown Prince saying that, or some kind of signing, or saying your letter in the New York Times or your piece in the New York Times was essentially acceptable to him, where that it didn't have to be a perfect replica of the 67 boundaries. You could give a little here and retreat a little here.
I met with Arafat after that was published, and I asked him, is this acceptable to you? And he said, yes.
So some settlement might be acceptable.
Oh, yes. He even said that at Camp David.
Right, I know.
He said in Camp David he's prepared to yield some territory. He was talking about 2%.
Okay, but here's what I hear you saying this evening. Notwithstanding the progress that's been made on the part of Sharon withdrawing, in terms of Sharon realizing certain strategies wouldn't work, the part of Arafat prepared to do this, and the next week the summit coming up, that you can't imagine this government in Israel making the deal that's on the table, which is called the Saudi Initiative.
That is correct.
So what happens, then something's got to change the Saudi Initiative and modify it to meet Israeli acceptance that does not so offend the Arabs and Arafat that they walk away.
Well, this government cannot do it, because this government has said it will never agree to a division of Jerusalem. So that, from the Saudi perspective, that's a deal breaker.
The Saudi?
Yes. And certainly from, and if it's a deal breaker for the Saudis, it's a deal breaker for the Palestinians and for the rest of the Arab world. Although the Saudis have said, as we discussed the last time, that they can live with East Jerusalem as the capital of a Palestinian state, but Israeli sovereignty over Jewish neighborhoods in East Jerusalem, which is a major accommodation for the Saudis and for the Arab.
And they deal with the right of return issue by saying, look, you know, they have the right of return, but they're not coming. Isn't that the way they're going to deal with it?
Well, that's not clear. They did not mention the right of return as one of the conditions that has to be satisfied.
Yeah, but subsequent to that, they began to talk about.
Others did, as I tried to get unanimous support at the upcoming meeting in Beirut for this deal. Others, Syria, Lebanon, other countries said, well, what about this issue? They've been very careful since then to use language that does not close the door to a symbolic settlement on the refugee issue, so that the symbol is preserved, which is to say the right of return is honored. But in its application, it will not bring back any significant numbers of refugees, certainly not the kinds of numbers that would threaten Israel's Jewish character.
I'm out of time here. So the thing we should watch for next is what?
What we ought to watch for next are two things. First, the kind of language they use in Beirut, if we're talking about the Arab,
right.
the Saudi
I'm talking
initiative.
About both sides, yeah.
We have to look at the kind of language they use so that they do not water down this notion of normal relations with Israel.
Yeah.
My prediction is that they will use the term normal relations. They will not use the term normalized, ties. Because in any event, normal for the Saudis is not tourists running around Mecca and Medina. So their notion of normal is a very limited one. That's one thing. You have to look at the language that is used with respect to not just the right of return as a principle, but its application. Whether they leave open, as I believe they probably will, a formula that does not really bring the refugees back. Most important, if you want violence to stop, what we need to look at is whether the United States is prepared to go in its discussions with Arafat beyond a vague promise of a horizon that includes the state of Palestine, but a roadmap that says this is the goal. We're talking essentially about the Saudi initiative, and that's what we're committing ourselves to. Short of that, violence will break out again, and we'll be back where we were.
Thank you. We'll be right back. Stay with us. Henry Yuen is the chairman and CEO of Gemstar-TV Guide International. The New York Times has said he has the potential to become, quote, the most powerful man in television. He founded the company in 1988 after failing to successfully record a Boston Red Sox game on his VCR. A trained mathematician and scientist, he's decided to come up with a foolproof mechanism to record programs. Since merging the company in 2000 with TV Guide, he has developed an interactive programming guide that helps viewers navigate through the television landscape. His goal is to build a first screen portal that will allow viewers to choose programs, make purchases, and tape their favorite shows. I am pleased to have him at this table for the very first time. Welcome. It's good to have you here.
Thank you very much, Charlie.
All right. Let's first talk about, there's so much to talk about, but let's do the baseball thing first. It is a true story. You being a rabid Red Sox fan had to go away, and you set your VCR to record, and for some reason it didn't happen, and you were then motivated to come up with what eventually became VCR Plus.
I still haven't figured out why I failed in the beginning, but I was glad I did. And yes, I was just thinking, actually two things motivated that. First, I thought the telephone exchange system is so complicated, yet you dial a number and you get to the other person virtually unerringly. Why can't we do it for recording a VCR? And that started the VCR Plus. But at the same time, I also happened to watch a news program around that time and found that Mr. Rupert Murdoch was purchasing South China Morning Post in Hong Kong, where I grew up.
Yeah.
And I had a friend who ran South China Morning Post. Then I thought I would have an introduction to the person that would make VCR Plus happen.
So you go back and you create VCR, and then you buy TV Guide. Give me what you have put together and what your vision of the future is, so that you might be, what the New York Times says, the most powerful man in television. What is it that you understand? What's the vision for Gemstar TV Guide?
Well, to me, I think part of it sits in the name. One of the things that I think will be developing very rapidly is television. The digital revolution is coming. Interactive television, I think, will be finally coming.
I'm glad you said that, because it can't get here soon enough for me.
That's great. And I think, you know, there are learning processes that we have to go through, because interactive television has to start with a pleasant, non-threatening, easy experience. And that's what guidance is all about. I think people still, as we stand today, buy television to watch television.
Mm-hmm.
And TV Guide Interactive, which is really taking TV Guide and put it on the TV screen, is really something that can give them a real pleasant experience to start and say, oh, this is what interactive is all about. It's nothing threatening. It's just allowing me to see what I want to see.
Okay, but explain what interactive means in your definition of TV Guide on the screen.
That's a very good question. Right now, the interactivity is what I would call local, which means that we anticipate what you want to do in the guide, and we actually load the data in advance.
Mm.
The television set itself, or the set-top box, is intelligent enough to execute your commands. So it looks like you're interacting with a TV, but there is no central processor that sits somewhere remote to talk to you. The next phase of interactivity is when you are able to communicate some of your input back into a central processor. And that's when you can buy things, you can vote, maybe you can chat, maybe you can influence the outcome of a show in an interactive fashion. Because the communication between your television set to a remote central processing unit is the next step in interactivity.
With all due respect and understanding of what convergence means to so many people, you know, from the internet and TV and data and voice and all that, you have had this firm belief that television is a far more powerful medium than the internet.
I would certainly think that it is the preferred medium by the consumers for their leisure habits. I mean, this is just proven by the 7 hours yeah. of television viewing, and that speaks louder than anything else.
But is that changing because of this whole generation of young people who are so much more connected to their PC and the internet and all that it offers them?
In fact, I don't think the numbers support that there is any significant change yet. Mm. As for the future, I think that there are two ways of changing. One is television will change in order to cope with the expectations of these younger people. That's exactly what we are talking about. We are designing part of a television that would appeal to the younger people who want to talk to the machine.
Yeah, television will become more like the internet then, more like the PC connected to the internet.
Precise.
You can go online in a sense with a TV. You can talk to it and it'll come back to you and deliver you whatever you want.
Correct. And actually, I mean, it's funny, you're right. The younger generation rather talk to the television or the PC than to their parents.
Yeah.
But the reality of the matter is they want something to interact with. There is still tremendous value of the television entertainment portion of it. And I think young people still watch television. That allows them to communicate with each other. There are common senses, common experience, and that's never going to go away.
There is also this thing, if you talk to people like Rupert Murdoch and Bill Gates and so many other people who've been sort of looking at this from an investment standpoint, they will say, certainly Bill Gates says this to me, the biggest disappointment for him has been the slow development of broadband. Right?
Yes.
He says that. Now, my point is, why has interactivity been so slow coming in terms of when everybody knew it had potential, everybody knew it offered applications that consumers would assume they'd like? Some will say the demand hasn't been there, and the problem has been for broadband and interactivity is the notion of consumer demand.
I think you hit the nail on the head. I think in the last 10, 15 years or 20 years, technology development had been breathtaking, but it also outstripped consumer demand. Now, on one hand, I think PC is a wonderful example of technology driving consumer demand, and I'm not going to take anything away from that. But when you go home and get relaxed, you need to have a feeling of familiarity. You have to be not threatened. You have to be relaxed. In that arena.
But you don't have to be passive.
Precisely. But the movement away from passiveness needs to be enticed, if you would say, by a good experience, by a non-threatening experience. I would say these are intertwined problems with the key in the consumer. Now, I think it is coming. Their experience in workplaces, their experience a certain degree at home with the internet, is going to get the concept of interactivity more and more familiar.
So I'm sitting in front of a television in the Henry Yuen view of the world. What will it be like? We're now at the beginning of 2002. What will it be like at the beginning of 2004, 2 years from now? What will be operative in terms of the world of interactivity? I'm sitting, I'm watching my television. I have a remote control in my hand. I turn my television on. Now, I may be getting a signal from a satellite, from digital cable. That's probably my two choices.
Well, you have satellite, digital cable, digital terrestrial.
Right.
May 2004, you still have analog channels.
Yeah. Where,
but all that put together.
Right. I turn my television on.
That, our goal is that in a very simple way, you get to what you probably would be most interested in watching very quickly. Okay, we should be able to seamlessly present the various different sources of feed, including perhaps the things that you recorded on your hard disk,
right?
Things that you have recorded yourself or being suggested to be recorded by the machine.
So those things that I've recorded over the last 24 hours will be there, or the last 2 hours.
Or whatever it is. Yes,
yeah.
That's right. Your recorded shows and the live shows will be sorted in the same fashion. You want to say, I want to watch interviews by Charlie Rose.
Yes.
That's what I want them to get to very, very quickly. Or you might say, I want to see all the Red Sox games. But that's only one vision of the 2004. Another vision is that you don't sit down and turn on your TV anymore. You may be walking around with a tablet where you might be on one, you know, in one moment reading a book on it. And that's why we want to go into e-book.
I know.
And
okay,
another moment switching to the channel, and you may get a reminder that says, Olympics is on. Do you want to switch?
Right.
And you just switch it. You can walk outside of your house. You can go into your, you can be at your pool. You can lounge around. You can be doing your exercise. You can be walking your dog. And you can still be entertained. And I believe mobile entertainment device will be the next generation of TV.
A tablet you walk around with in your hand.
Absolutely.
It's the size of a piece of paper. But
probably, yes. And depending on what it tries to give you an experience of. If it comes from the book concept, it should be the size of a book. If it comes from a, you know, a tablet concept, it may be larger, it may be smaller, it may be as big as a newspaper. That's really up to what your preference
And just to underline what we're talking about here, what part of that do you own? What of Henry's will I see?
Okay. We had entered the e-book market.
Right.
And what we want to do is, first, we want to enter that market by producing something which first match or hopefully exceed your experience currently, which is that we want to design an electronic book which in every way an avid reader like you or me would agree it's a better experience than a paper.
Yeah, I don't know how that's going to happen, I got to tell you. But
I have to convince you. I'm an avid reader, and I was convinced.
Right.
Now, then what I would like to do is to put in the added convenience that they can also watch TV on it. And when they watch TV, they need our guidance property as well.
Mm.
So obviously,
to tell you what's on TV.
What's on TV. There may be a prompt. There may be anything. So you can actually switch from TV to book to newspaper to magazine just like that.
And if I want a pizza?
You order it.
Right there, I can click on.
Exactly.
Now, the genius of Steve Case was that he understood that AOL had to be user-friendly. This is essential here for you, too.
Absolutely essential. In fact, when we combined with a couple of other companies that designed guides, you really have two extreme routes you can take. Throw in all the features that each have and make it into a super duper guide. Or take the best of all, okay, and make it a very simple guide. We took the second. Because we continue to think that the consumer experience includes not being threatened, includes don't be very difficult.
It's the reason most people make jokes about they can't program their VCR.
Yes,
it's not that hard, but people can't get over that point.
It's a perceived problem that you never want to step in and make it bigger with your solution.
Yeah.
You have to make it smaller, and you have to make them feel comfortable.
What has to happen from the technological standpoint in order to get there to where you think we might be in 2004? Or is the technology already there and we're only waiting for?
Technology is already there.
So you could do this tomorrow?
Yes, at very high cost.
Right,
it's not
right.
a mass deployment yet. Mm. First, with regards to back channel, that's going to be definitely there. It's here already. I mean, the broadband two-way, it's just not rapidly deployed in mass enough. So the two-way interactivity is already there. As for the wireless, this is what is called a local area network.
Right.
8211A is a well-developed technology. You can actually see it, you can walk around, and you can tune to as many channels as you want.
Most entrepreneurs and visionaries and people who are out there have to compete with other people who have similar ideas, maybe different business models. Who are your competitors? Is it TiVo?
Well, in fact, we have so many competitors. First of all, if we first talk about just the
or replay.
Yes, interact. Actually, TiVo and Replay are not really competitors. They are potential customers of ours. They develop good technology on hard disk recording.
Right.
We don't do hard disk recording. We just think that our interactive program guide is
you just
a
want to
perfect
make part-
match
right.
for that. Because if you have a great recording device, don't you have to find out what you want to record?
Right.
So they are not competitors. They are actually, we very much are hopeful that we'll work together.
Who's the competitor?
The competitor, in the purest of sense, are people who are services that would take away attention of the consumers from us. And interestingly, even a tennis match on an outdoor whatever, because to us, being able to reach the consumer is our ultimate goal. We want to be as much front and center in their mindset by being useful. So we compete. We have to make our product attractive. We have to make it easy to use, because all they have to do, consumer-wise, is to say, I'd rather go watch a show and don't want to watch TV, regardless of how easy you think you made it. It wasn't easy enough for me. So we are very much on the side of television. We want to make television as much useful, attractive to people as possible, and our portion of the service as attractive as possible.
How important is the TV Guide brand name?
Infinitely important.
Infinitely.
I think it is very rare that that much trust can be deposited into a little brand like that. This is our 50th anniversary.
TV Guide
started 50 years ago. And today, of course, it's evolved. This is not just the magazine now. There's the channel, there's the interactive program guide, there's the .com. It is still, brand-wise, one of the most recognized brand that comes with it the trust and comes with it the instant recognition that this is something that helps me watch TV.
What's the satisfaction for you? I mean, because you are said to be a man who, I think you even quoted as saying, you know, I'm not very good at figuring out how to spend money. You know, you love the Red Sox. We
yes.
know that. You have said, you know, I really wanted to move from science to business because I found business more exciting, you know. So it obviously had, it's not clear to me that you are driven by not being worth a billion or 2 billion, maybe 3 or 4 billion. You're not driven by that. You're driven by something else.
I think the easiest way to say it is, I'm driven by having a dream and seeing it come through. And I'm very, very fortunate that virtually by chance with VCR Plus, I was able to perceive a problem, solve it for the consumer, because I'm also a consumer, and then see it actually work. And Interactive Program Guide, Next Step, Interactive TV, ebook, it's the same thing. I really believe it's something that I, as a consumer, obviously I don't speak for the consumer, but as a consumer, it would be attractive. And it would make a difference in how they spend their leisure time. And to be able to do that is extremely exciting for me. I mean, I can't wait to get up every day and hopefully move further along that path. That's what's exciting.
Okay. Let me just ask this last question. For a long time, we all debated all the things that were coming into the home and whether there would be a winner. Would it be cable or would it be telephone? Would it be wireless or not? I mean, do you have an opinion on that?
No. I think in a very near term, I think cable, satellite will be growing, digital cable and satellite will be growing areas. There could be, now of course there is, as you pointed out, telephony, there's digital terrestrial, all that would come in. But I think this is very, very hard to predict. First of all, I think it's wonderful for the consumer to be able to have so many choices. That I think is wonderful. And I think it really depends a lot on the business models, whether they meet the consumer's need. And I think at the end of the day, if you are a consumer service, you know who the ultimate judge is. That's the consumer.
Thank you for coming.
Thank you very much.
Julia Louis-Dreyfus is here. For 9 years, she starred as Elaine on Seinfeld, earning 7 nominations for an Emmy, and she won one time.
This woman is genetically engineered to go to a ball. Tall, blonde, live.
Live?
Live.
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 Oh, live.
No, you two have a great time there.
It can't be worse than this.
Where do you see the dress that she's got? It's backless, eh? I'm finally gonna make a great entrance.
Backless? You gonna back her in?
Elaine, when a woman makes a ball entrance, she twirls.
She's not gonna twirl.
She'll twirl.
Seems like only yesterday. In 1998, Seinfeld left the air as one of the most critically praised and popular sitcoms of all time. Now, Louis-Dreyfus returns to television with her own show, Watching Ellie. Here is a look at this program.
I haven't been sleeping very well.
Probably need a massage.
Oh, that's fine. Hello? Oh, there you are, darling.
I can't talk.
No, wait. What's wrong?
Everything.
What everything? What's going on?
All right, listen. Let me give you a hypothetical situation.
Okay.
Suppose my big blonde Englishman was cheating on me in a bookstore in Hollywood while I was hiding out the oversized travel book section.
Ew. Really?
Yeah. Really?
I'm pleased to welcome this well-known actress to this table for the very first time. Welcome.
Thank you so much for having me.
My pleasure. Seems like only yesterday that Seinfeld left the air, doesn't it? Or not?
Not to
or
me.
Or not.
No, I mean,
it seems like forever.
We did a long time, and I guess we finished that thing about 3 years ago, 3.5 years ago. So
yeah.
But it sure was a heck of a lot of fun to do. There's no doubt about that.
Sure made a difference in your life.
A huge difference in my life. A huge difference in my life. Yeah, a very happy difference. I mean, because it was so satisfying creatively.
Yeah. Why? What made it that satisfying? Was that the fact that you... Let me offer possibilities. Okay?
All right.
You can choose one.
A, B,
choose
C, one,
a,
or
B, C. One, brilliantly written.
Mm. Yes, correct.
B, a wonderful ensemble group of actors.
Uh-huh.
Three, it just had the X factor. Something makes a magical show, and that had it. ABC.
ABC. I guess all three, but I'm not sure. I mean, I think it was extraordinary that we all were lucky enough to come together. But once we came together, it was sort of there. I mean, I don't think there was magic beyond that. I mean, it was just a great group of people at the right place at the right time. And we had a lot of fun. We enjoyed the process, and I think that translated.
After the end of Seinfeld, did you then think, what's next for me? And begin to say, however long it takes, I'll wait until I find what's just right for...
I wasn't focused on working after Seinfeld at all. I didn't have an agenda.
Really?
Mm-mm.
Just take the money and go.
I actually wanted to just chill out and sort of be at home for a really long time. I have two children. And
well, what'd you name these children?
One of them is Henry, and the other one is, of course, Charlie. My two favorite names.
Great.
And
we don't call Henry Hank, do we? We call him Henry.
No, we call him Henry.
Good.
Yeah.
Yeah, we like that. Don't call him Hank.
No.
Ever.
Henry is very
Henry's
dignified.
Good. No, it has a great sound to it. And
thank
Henry
you.
And Charlie sounds good, too.
Yeah, and they're good boys.
They are? Yeah. How old are they now?
9 and 4.
Henry's 9?
Yeah.
And Charlie's four.
Yeah.
And do they like each other?
Sure. Well, I mean, as much as siblings can.
Yeah, right. Right.
You know, let's be realistic. Yeah. But I went home and I sort of hung out at home for 3 years, essentially, and did that.
Getting to know your family.
Well, I knew them already, and I liked them, and I think that's why I wanted to be home. And that was nice. And then...
Were you holding this table up?
Yeah, it's wobbly, and I'm thinking about fixing it. In fact, can somebody bring in a
carpenter?
Tool kit?
Yeah, we'll fix this.
Anyway, so that's what I did. I didn't have a work agenda at all. And then I would say I started to get the itch a little bit. I worked with Larry, Larry David.
Right,
I did Curb Your Enthusiasm, and I don't know, that was exciting and fun to sort of feel the work thing happening again and exercise that muscle, and it felt good, and I started to get a little bit of a bug to get back to work.
And then your husband.
Then my husband.
Being a heck of a guy he is.
Yeah.
Creates Watching Ellie.
Yeah. He did. He created it and sort of presented it to me. Not sort of. He presented it to me. He didn't tell me he was doing this. Yeah. So it was kind of exciting. Yeah. It was very exciting. And he and I had been talking. I had been talking to him about if I were to go back to TV, I would have to do something very different. I'd have to sort of push the edge of the envelope, because otherwise it would just be a bummer. I didn't want to do the same thing. Even if the same thing was good, I needed to make a different thing. And so he came up with this concept of the show, that is to say, the real time.
Yeah.
Idea.
22 minutes actual time.
Exactly.
In the life of Ellie.
Exactly. Right. And so that was exciting.
Now, how hard is it to do that, or how easy? You have one camera.
We have one camera and the
real time.
Right. We have real time and one camera. So it's very different than doing the kind of television that I had been used to doing. Mm. It's shot like a movie, so it's very, you know, you don't rehearse for 3 days and then shoot for a day and a half, like, frankly, we did. That's how we did Seinfeld,
right,
for the most
right.
part. You shoot every single day, and each episode takes about 5 days to shoot. And then, of course, the real time is this puzzle for everybody in terms of telling the story, and, of course, in terms of kind of continuity of coming around a corner, yeah. and making sure that everything connects. We've set up this formula that we must go by every week, and it's really challenging and thrilling.
Do you define yourself as a comedian or an actor?
An actor. I've never done stand-up or anything like that. Ooh. But
why? Because does the thought of doing stand-up just send chills through you?
Yes, it does. Yeah, it's a very different way of performing.
Yeah.
Very different.
And yet, probably Jerry today even. Would define himself as a stand-up comedian than he would as an actor or a sitcom creator or anything like that.
I'm sure of that, yeah.
What he loves most, he once said.
Yeah, and I mean, he always said on the set he wasn't an actor, and we would always tease him about...
About what?
give him tips on how to act.
Is
walk
that
over
right?
there, be funny.
Oh, you would tell him,
we're not
we'll
funny.
Help you through this.
Yeah, sure. Yeah, I mean, he's the first one to admit it.
Yeah. What's his genius, you think?
Stand-up comedy.
Yeah,
I think that he enjoys what he does, and that comes through.
Absolutely.
Mm-hmm.
You know, you may have heard me say that in a conversation. Will Smith talked to me about that. The idea that if you are having a wonderful time,
it translates.
It's infectious.
It is.
You know?
Yeah, it's completely
people,
true.
It's like, you know.
Yeah, that's what was so great about doing Seinfeld, actually, is that we were having so much fun, and then other people. We're digging it. It was like, wow, this is so cool.
That can be better.
Yeah.
Was Saturday Night Live like that?
No.
It was awful.
In a word, no.
No.
No, it wasn't.
Why not?
Well,
another big
many
break
reasons.
For you.
Well, it was a big break for me, yeah, for sure. And it was definitely a great training ground for me, there's no doubt. And in the fact that it was extremely difficult to do. I was very young, and I was unbelievably naive.
Now you're old, and
now that
not
I'm an old
naive.
Hag. I didn't know how the business worked, and I didn't know how that show worked. And there's a lot of politics about getting your material on the air. And you know, I came from doing sort of ensemble work and improvisational. We're a team, and stuff like that. Stuff doesn't translate.
Plus, you were a graduate of Northwestern.
Yeah, exactly.
Or you attended Northwestern.
I attended. Yeah, yeah. I actually left Northwestern to do SNL.
Yes, I know.
But at any rate, that was hard, and it was hard to be a woman there, and there wasn't
hard
a lot
to be
of
a woman there.
Oh,
what
yeah.
does that mean?
Well, it means that they weren't writing material for women. Writers were much more inclined to write for the men.
Why was that?
I don't know. I guess they thought the guys
were
funnier.
Because today they've got lots of female characters, don't they?
Yeah, they do today. But this was not today.
It's not today.
Yeah.
This was when? What would you, when
this
were you
there? This was 1983 to 86.
Was that a good year?
1983?
Yeah.
No.
84?
No, none of it.
85?
Exactly. There were things on the show that were good, but, yeah. You know.
It but was you don't so have hard. Great memories about.
Mm-mm, not really. No, I don't. I mean, is that terrible to say? I don't really.
No, of course not.
It was fine. I'm not kidding. I really did learn a lot about how the business worked.
Yeah.
But it wasn't creatively satisfying. But I will tell you one thing. I came out of that show and I said to myself, I'm not going to do anything again unless it's fun.
And fun.
Fun.
And so then when you got to Seinfeld, you said, Jesus.
This is fun. And what also was good came out of Seinfeld. Well, I knew Larry David. Larry David was a writer on SNL. And that's how come he sent me these Seinfeld scripts, because he knew me. And so that's something good that came out of it.
So he gets the credit for Elaine, doesn't he?
Yeah, sure.
I mean...
He wrote it.
He wrote it, and not only that, he thought you'd be perfect.
Yeah.
I mean, you walked in, and they just said, bingo. I mean, it was not a whole lot of maybe, maybe, maybe.
It was
walk in, bingo.
Yeah.
We found our Elaine.
Yeah, that was nice. It was great. And when we were doing Seinfeld, and when I read those scripts of Larry's, and I thought, God, are we going to be able to get away with this? Because that show was not written like most television shows.
How so?
the conversations were not particularly meaningful. They were small conversations that were funny.
Yeah, funny, right.
And that appealed to me tremendously.
You'll do 15 episodes of this for this season?
Well, actually,
have they already bought more? Or?
No, not yet. I mean for next season?
Yeah.
Not yet.
Yeah.
Not yet. But we'll do, in fact, we're doing 13 this season, and then subsequent seasons will be 15. Yeah. And I'm you know, delighted that we've been able to pull that off.
Apart from the family,
yes.
The husband and your two sons, apart from this successful sitcom, what's your biggest passion for?
Oh, God. You know, besides eating and
stuff? Yeah, well, eating is passion.
Well, sure. I mean, what's not to like about food?
Yes.
What's my passion? I would say I'm passionate about the environment. And
right.
I do political work for the environment. But besides that, I just really enjoy making people laugh. That's my thing. That's really what I like to do.
And you do it well.
Thank you very much.
Great to have you here.
Thank you for
Will you come
me.
Back?
Yeah. When?
Don't press me. Thank you.
Thank you very much.
Thank you for joining us. We'll see you next time.
Charlie Rose is made possible by these funders.
And by Bloomberg, a provider of multimedia news and information services worldwide.
To order Charlie Rose program transcripts and video cassettes, call 1-800-ALL-NEWS or write to the address on your screen. Please indicate show date and guest.
This is PBS.
The next Charlie Rose, two strong proponents of making protecting the environment a high priority. They are E.O. Wilson of Harvard and the author, Peter Matheson. Join us.